I looked around and I saw na imbes na mag-drift apart yung marriage namin ng asawa ko, lalo kaming tumibay together. I looked around and I saw yung mga tao sa paligid namin na hindi napagod mag-reach out sa amin para ipaalala sa amin mahal na mahal pa rin kami ng Diyos at hindi kami nag-iisa, na nasaktan kami pero hindi kami pinabayaan, nawalan kami pero hindi kami iniwan. That even in our pain, God was present and He was journeying with us. Hi, I'm Mimi Salvosa Trinidad. Before I joined the Feast, I was already an active member sa parish namin and in the campus ministry. So, I learned about Jesus through my parents kasi bata pa lang kami. Hinahatak na nila kami sa parish to serve. I remember that when I was a child, I had a sickness, a blood illness na bordering na siya to leukemia. So, my doctor then told us that I had limited time na lang to live. But then my parents, nakita ko sa kanila yung pagpipray. Tapos kahit parang puro pasapasa na yung katawan ko, tapos nagsusuka ako madalas, I had to stop studying. Nakita ko sa kanila na hindi sila tumigil na magdasal at manalig. Nagagaling ako. And true enough, yun nga, gumaling ako. I went back to school. And then nag-start yung personal relationship ko with God. Somehow, parang feeling ko totoo na siya, hindi lang siya biblical stories. When I got older, high school, sinali kami ni na mama sa choir. So, doon ako nag-start to know God more in a personal way. And then, naging paraan din yun para mas makilala ko yung God na nababasa ko lang dati sa scriptures, because naging lector din ako, naging member din ako ng parish youth missions. And then when I got into college, naging member din ako ng campus ministry. So back then, wala talaga akong idea about charismatic community life. Parang sa akin din, service was limited lang sa parish, sa simbahan, sa building, sa mga events. Hindi ko alam yung depth ng service when it comes to community life. Remember, parang isang afternoon, bigla na lang ako nagkasakit. Yung mataas na mataas na lagnat. Tapos di ako pinapasok ni na mama. And then, humaba yung lagnat ko. Tapos nag-decide sila na ipa-check up na ako. And then, I did some labs. Tapos doon nakita na may blood defect nga ako, blood disorder. So, ang naririnig ko lang nun kina mama, leukemia. Parang puro ganun. But they were trying to filter the details sa akin. And then, eventually, parang napapadalas yung pagpunta namin sa hospital, may gamutan, tapos may ini-inject sa akin. Parang eventually, nakita ko puro pasana yung katawan ko. Hirap na akong bumangon. Hindi ako makalakad kasi sumasakit lahat ng joints ko. Sumasakit yung buong katawan ko. Tapos, kailangan ko nang huminto sa pag-aaral because I had to focus on my medication. So, it happened when I was around grade 2 or 3. I think doon ako huminto ng pag-aaral. So, yun nga, habang yung ibang bata nag-aaral, ako nasa bahay lang. Tapos, hindi rin ako makapaglaro sa labas kasi andali kong mapagod. Andali kong hingalin. Tapos, konting kainin ko, sinusuka ko. Tapos, ang nagbabantay sa akin nun, sina mama at papa, and then yung lola ko. Nakita ko kayo na mama kasi hirap na hirap sila sa medications because siguro costly. Madalas talaga nilalagnat ako, pinapawisan ako. Pati yung mga kapatid ko since bata pa, hindi rin nila naiintindihan ko anong nangyayari sa akin. Nung nag-stop akong mag-aral, parang dun ko nakita yung difference ko sa ibang bata, na sila na-enjoy nila yung school. Tapos ako, nasa bahay lang. Parang dun ko na-feel initially na parang out of place ako, ganyan. So, sina mama at papa, pinipilit pa rin nila akong dalhin sa simbahan. Parang binubuhat nila ako sa sasakyan para makapagsimba. But there was one time na nahimatay ako kasi habang nagsisimba. Parang nag-blackout ako. So, hindi na nila inulit yon. Parang doon na lang ako. Hindi na nila ako sinasama magsimba. Nabantay na lang ako ni Lola. So, sina mama at papa, nag-start yung pag-rosary namin gabi-gabi for my healing. Gabi yung medication ko kasi noon. So parang ang laki nung na-spend. So much so that when I went back to school from private, minuva ko sa public. Kasi naubos na yung funds namin because of the medication. So I think, sabi lang nung doctor, nadaan sa gamot, ganun. Pero ang sinasabi ni na mama, nadaan sa faith, nadaan sa dasal, because I think only God can do that. Na parang dapat wala na, I was supposed to die, pero nalabanan namin yung sakit. And although of course may medical intervention, my parents really believed that it was God's work. Actually, my parents played a big role in my faith because I saw that faith in them when I was sick. Yung pagdadasal para sa akin, yung pagtuturo nila sa amin ng daily rosary, yung pagmamass regularly, parang yun yung usual sa culture natin Filipino, yung basic na catechism. Parang I really wanted to know God on a personal level. So, yun yung parang may thirst ako talaga to know that God. I was curious to know the God who healed me. When I eventually grew up, when I reached high school, I think one of the reasons why I chose to serve was because, yun nga, parang fired up talaga ako mag-serve kay God. Actually, mas fired up talaga akong makilala siya than service. Tapos parang naging avenue ko lang yung service to really know this God. So I joined the campus ministry in the University of the East Manila. Para kasing feeling ko kulang pa, parang gusto ko pang laliman yung relationship ko with God. That's when I met new friends. Just for context, yun nga, dahil lumaki nga ako na parang for a time huminto ako sa pag-aaral, naging aloof ako sa mga tao. So most of my years, I was a listener and parang lagi ako nakamask as a strong person. Parang I used to be always the strong and collected one. So as a servant leader, ganun yung facade ko. Parang bihira akong iiyak sa harap ng maraming tao. Lagi lang akong makikinig. Pero nung nasa campus ministry ako, doon ako nakakilala ng mga friends na nagturo sa akin mag-start na mag-open up unti-unti. So, if there's one word that I could use to describe my childhood, siguro, it would be hopeful. Kasi despite what I've been through, parang somehow I knew in my heart na umaasa kong things would be better, na parang feeling ko makakalabas din ako ng kwarto. And in essence, parang makakalabas din ako ng mundo ko. Na hindi ko kailangan na nakakulong lang ako, magiging katulad din ako ng ibang normal na bata, ganyan. That everything would be okay. I was in college when I first heard about the feast. Actually, parang naka-attend kami once sa Marilao, kaya nagka-idea kami na magkakaroon ng lunch sa SM Manila, which was nearer to my school. So, nalaman namin yung lunch date, umattend ako. When I got to the venue, pero isang lalaking lumapit sa akin, tapos medyo maliit lang siya. Tapos, naka-long sleeve siya, tapos parang taas-taas ng energy niya. Tapos sabi niya, hey, welcome to the feast, ganyan. Tapos sabi ko, hala, sino to? Hindi ko siya kilala kasi. Tapos nagpakilala siya, sabi niya, my name is Brother Obet Cabrillas, and thank you for coming here. And at the time, inaya ko yung mga iba kong kasama sa campus ministry kasi nga, parang na-experience ko na yung feast before. So I wanted also them to experience. Tapos parang gusto ko lang i-try kung ano yung difference kung sa may mga youth, parang youth vibes. Tapos, nagulat ako nung may lalaking nakapula, tapos tumatalong sa stage. Tapos, ano siya, eventually nalaman ko pangalan niya, Paolo Galia pala. Tapos, parang yung mga kasamahan ko, sa kanya din na shock. Parang, ha, pwede palang mag-worship ng ganun? Ganito pala yung youth energy talaga. It was very new to me. But then, I felt at home. It was my first time attending the feast. Pero I really felt at home because of the embrace of the people around me, yung pag-welcome nila. So much so that every week, lagi akong may dalang mga bagong kasama. It's either dormmates ko, classmates ko, kakampus ministry friends ko. Because I really wanted to share with them the joy that I felt when I first attended the feast. Lagi ko rin silang tinatanong, oh, anong feeling? Parang pagkatapos umatin, oh, anong feeling? May dormmate ako, sobrang vivid sa akin yung pagkakadescribe. Sabi niya, parang mababaliw ako. Kasi nung nakikinig daw siya ng talk, umiiyak siya. Tapos nung nag-worship na, parang kumakalma na siya. Tapos nung praise song na, parang energetic siya. Sabi niya, parang lahat ng emotions niya daw na-touch because first time niya daw i-open yung sarili niya sa ganung klaseng environment. And he really felt na kinausap siya at experience siya yung love ni Lord through the feast. Growing up, pangalawa ko sa magkakapatid eh. Pero I consider myself as the emotional eldest. So parang hindi ako yung panganay, pero ako yung may responsibility. So parang maaga ako nag-mature ganun. Sanay nga ako na ako yung matapang, ako yung matatag. Parang dapat laging i-check ko yung sarili ko. Bawal akong umiyak sa harap ng mga tao. Bawal akong manghina. But when I joined the feast, doon ko na-realize na pwede pala akong umiyak. Na hindi pala expected na dahil servant ako, dapat perfect ako. O na dapat malakas ako. O na dapat laging alam ko yung sagot. It really helped me that nakita ko yon sa examples ng mga leaders namin. So, I joined a caring group. It was called caring group pa before. Pero ngayon light group na. And I was under Kuya Paolo Galia. He was one of the worship leaders back then. So, siya yung humawak sa akin as a caring group member sa youth missions. So, pag nakita mo kasi si Kuya pa, parang ang strong niya eh. So, parang nakaka-relate ako sa kanya na parang strong, parang reliable, maaasahan mo. Pero during CG sessions namin, maririnig mo yung mga struggles niya din. Ay, umiiyak din pala siya. Ay, nasasaktan din pala siya. Tapos doon ko na-realize na pwede pala akong maging wounded na servant. Pwede pala akong maging struggling na leader. Hindi pala kabawasan yon sa pagiging servant ko, sa pagiging Kristiyano ko, kung ipapakita ko na nasasaktan din ako. When I saw that, and I saw that then kapag nagsishare si Brother Obet Cabrillas, na madalas minsan umiiyak pa siya, yung mga struggles niya, ganyan. Doon ako unti-unting natutong i-open up yung sarili ko sa iba. And yung caring group namin, parang sila yung mga tao unang nakakita ng aking weakest and ugliest part siguro ng life ko. Yung most hurting part ng life ko, sila yung unang nakakita. Natutunan ko na pwede ko palang ipakita yung sugat ko, tapos mamahalin pa rin ako.
When we were still younger, so when I think she was still a student, we were part of a light group together. I was their head, and one particular night, medyo ano yun, actually movie night. Nanood kami ng My Amnesia Girl. So nanood kami ng My Amnesia Girl sa isang bahay lang din, sama-sama kami with our LG. We were five or six in a group. And man, nanood ng movie, tapos nagkwentuhan, kumain, syempre, you know, part of a light group, syempre may kainan. Tapos after nun, nag-process kami ng movie. Pero yung processing, yun yung ginawa naming LG question. Kasi nga may amnesia girl. So ang tanong is, what part in your life do you want to forget? So medyo, ano na, medyo malalim. So medyo nag-start na, ano lang, mababaw. But it really came to a point where the light group really shared, each of us shared, you know, a really, kumbaga, dark or a something that we regret doing or something we really want to forget. And she shared something that really took me back. And nung nakwento ni Maymay yun, nung LG, yun nga, parang tahimik kami lahat. Siya, nung kinikwento niya, umiiyak siya. And actually, she was really struggling na share. But I think there was a sense for her that, you know, it's okay. It's okay to share. Pero kita mo yun eh. Kita mo yung medyo torn siya. And si Maymay, pag nagsalita yan, very confident. She's a confident speaker. She speaks well. But during that time, alam mo yung medyo para yung boses na, yung nanganga, na, yung ba nangangatog or gumagaralgal na yung boses niya because she was struggling to say and to share because I think it was really dear to her. And parang medyo may feeling of mix of shame and embarrassment and regret na parang, why is this happening? But okay, maybe let's look at the blessing of it or maybe there's a reason. And it was really hard for us, especially for me, because I don't think I have heard a heavy story as that, you know, before that night. So, meron ako namang marinig ng mga ibang bagay. Pero that particular instance na straight from a person that I've been talking to. Minsan kasi may maririnig ka lang sa TV or sa interviews or, you know, but really from a person just as close to you, alam mo yun. And from coming from so much fun, like, my Amnesia Girl comedy fun, diba? Pero then she shared that and she bared that to us it was really parang grabe. Ngayon parang, you know, we look back to it and we see a night really that a night to remember kasi wala, pagkatapos yun, iyakan talaga kami. I think it was a flow of God's forgiveness and just showing to us that these are safe people that we can be around with. And we're so blessed to, ako, I'm so blessed that Maymay was able to share that because it showed a side of her. And I think it reminded us that, you know, kahit mukha lang malakas or mukha ka lang tumatawa-tawa dyan, pero, you know, each of us are going really through problems. And yun. Nung na-share na yun, I saw from her relief and we just hugged each other. And actually, even when we were hugging and we were praying with each other, there was a sense of, you know, a sense of sadness because we really, walang makapagbigay ng advice. Shoot, paano ba to? Bigat naman ito, ako yung head. But I didn't know what to say because, but you know, we just prayed and we just showed her that we'll support her and we'll be with her and we'll journey with her despite that. And that's what we did, I think.
So since 2009, Feast Manila has been my home. And from being a member of the dance ministry, naging partner rin ako ng worship team and then eventually ng pastoral ministry. Kasi from youth, naging member ako ng singles ministry. And then sila na rin yung naka-witness nung nagpakasal kami ng asawa ko because I met my husband, Erickson, sa youth missions din. So we were serving together. So nung nagpakasal kami ng 2018, we decided to parang look for another feast that would be nearer to us kasi sa Bulacan kami nakabase. So medyo naging mahirap na sa amin na magbiyahe from Bulacan to Manila. Unlike nung students kami kasi sa Manila din kami nag-aaral. So it was easier for us. So, but habang naghahanap kami, tuloy pa rin yung service namin. Erickson was also invited to co-preach sometimes at the feast. And ako parang nag-lead pa din ng worship paminsan-minsan. That would be loved. Kasi yun yung time na natututunan ko nang i-open yung sarili ko sa ibang tao. To show other people my weaknesses, my vulnerabilities. And still, I felt loved and accepted despite those. So, in August 2018, Erickson and I got married. Sobrang saya namin nun kasi parang finally, parang we're starting a new chapter together, ganyan. And then, what made us happier was, a month later, we found out that we were pregnant with our honeymoon baby. Syempre, sobrang saya kasi parang, what, ang bait-bait naman ni Lord kasi honeymoon baby yung binigay niya sa amin. But that happiness was short-lived because after just a few weeks, we found out that our baby, we named her Pia, that Pia lost her heartbeat on her supposedly 8th week. So, sobrang devastated kami nung gabi na yon. Naalala ko kasi noon, malapit lang yung hospital sa amin, actually. Sa pagpunta namin doon, na habang nakahiga ako doon sa in-ultrasound kami, the doctor was explaining na wala nang heartbeat, ganyan-ganyan. Tapos, ang dami niya pang sinabi, pero hindi ko na na-absorb yung ibang sinabi niya. Parang, na-stuck na ako doon sa sinabi niya, wala nang heartbeat. Tapos, nag-start na mag-flow yung tears ko habang sinasabi niya yon. Tapos, nakahawak lang ako sa kamay ni Erickson, and the doctor was explaining yung mga next steps, ganyan. Tapos, walang nagsisink in sa akin at all. Hindi ko alam. Tapos, paglabas namin ng hospital, mula sa hospital hanggang sa bahay namin, nilakad namin ni Erickson. Kasi, umiiyak kami. Parang pareho kaming tulala. Pareho kaming in a daze. Hindi namin ma-absorb bakit ganun yung nangyari. Parang, yung word nga ni Erickson, masama ba kaming tao? may ginawa ba kaming mali? Ganyan. Hindi namin talaga alam yung gagawin namin. So, the first thing that I did was, may kakilala kami sa feast na isang ubigay ni. So, minessage namin siya. We asked him kung ano po yung gagawin. And kung ano yung result. Tapos, ano yung gagawin. Tapos, nag-advise siya to wait for another 2 weeks. Ganyan. And then, he comforted us. Pero pag uwi namin ng bahay, parang everything was in shambles. Talaga parang hindi ko alam kung ano yung nangyayari. Actually, hindi ko nga alam paano kami naka-uwi na ni Erickson. Kasi ang natatandaan ko lang, umiiyak kami habang naglalakad mula sa hospital pa uwi ng bahay. So sabi niya, maghintay daw ng 2 weeks. So naghintay kami ng 2 weeks. Tapos, nagpa-ultrasound kami ulit. Wala pa rin heartbeat. Tapos, ayokong pumayag. Nag-ultrasound pa kami ulit. Pupunta kami sa mas malaking hospital. Nag-ultrasound pa kami ulit. Walang heartbeat. Unang beses na nalaman naming walang heartbeat si Pia, September 24. Birthday ni Erickson, October 3. Inabot na kami ng birthday ni Erickson. Parang sabi ko, anak, pa-birthday natin kay tatay. Sana may heartbeat ka, ganyan. Sana mali. Alam mo yung sobrang in denial talaga ako na walang heartbeat. Pagpunta namin sa hospital, of course, same results. Walang heartbeat. Tapos doon ako talaga umiyak na umiyak na parang, wala na talaga si Pia. Wala na siya talaga. So, nag-sorry pa ako kay Erickson na, sorry, ganito yung birthday celebration mo. Magkahawak lang kami talaga na kamay habang nasa biyahe. Parang din ko naintindihan yung samang sinusulat sa kanta, na parang bakit normal yung paligid ng iba, parang hindi nyo ba nakikitang nasasaktan kami, yung mga ganong linya. Because that's how I felt. Parang, bakit kayo tumatawa? Bakit kayo nakangiti? Namatayin kami ng anak, walang heartbeat yung anak na yun. Parang, Bakit parang normal yung lahat? Nabang kami, parang di namin alam kung ano yung gagawin namin. So, after ilang weeks, yun na, I started to have labor pains. Tapos, nasa bahay kami nun. Parang nagkaroon ako ng cramps. And then, dinugo na ako ng dinugo hanggang sa madaling araw, nilabas ko na si Pia sa kwarto namin. Tapos, kinabukasan, blinesh namin siya pagkalabas namin. Sinabi sa amin ng mga ninong at ninang namin who also experienced miscarriage na paglabas ni Pia, i-bless namin siya with holy water, i-baptize namin siya. So that's what we did bago namin siya dalhin sa hospital. So parang pinabless din namin siya muna kina mama, dun sa mga tao sa bahay, sa mga pinsan niya. Tapos, yun. Then we went to the hospital and then I had a dilation and curettage to remove entirely kung ano pa yung baka natirang mga blood or sac sa akin, Pia. Even after that miscarriage, we continued serving sa Feast Manila. Dahil nga parang maselan yung pregnancy ko noon, hindi ako nakaka-attend ng feast. So si Erickson yung nagsuserve. So yun nga, parang he was invited to co-preach sometimes. So tuloy-tuloy pa rin service namin. When I was when I already recovered from the DNC, nagli-lead ako ng worship. Tapos iisa lang yung prayer ko na parang, Lord, just strengthen us. Just strengthen us. Kung paano mo ko pinalakas throughout the years. Yung andami na natin pinagdaanan together. Parang walang naghanda sa akin sa ganitong klaseng sakit. Pero palakasin mo ko. Just please strengthen us. And that's what he did. Nagulat ako na parang one day, nakakangiti na ako ulit. Nakakatawa na ako ulit. And it came as a surprise to me nung nakita ko yung pictures na parang, ay, parang unti-unti na pala akong nag-heal. Somehow. And I think it's only the grace of God that was able to heal me. Yun nga, ang biggest realization ko when I lost Pia was, God is the strength that I didn't know I have. Akala ko matapang na ako, akala ko malakas na ako, pero at that point, I realized na may ilalakas pa pala ako at yung Diyos yun. Yun yung lakas na galing sa Kanya. Pero that newfound strength was short-lived kasi parang after a few months, in June 2019, the following year, we found out that we're pregnant again. So parang, yay! Ang saya. But unlike dun sa first miscarriage, parang mas konti yung sinabihan namin ngayon. Kasi nga, parang we wanted to make sure na okay, na viable yung pregnancy, na okay si baby, ganyan. Pero we asked a few friends and community members to pray for us kasi kailangan talaga namin ng prayers. Pero, same result, parang after ilang weeks lang, when we went back sa, for the ultrasound, we found out na hindi nag-develop si baby. So, another miscarriage, our second miscarriage. So, yung second miscarriage namin, yun yung mas masakit for me. Kasi, hindi lang kami nawala ng anak. Nawala siya sa amin on the day of our first wedding anniversary. So unang anniversary ng kasal namin, nagluluksa kami. Yung araw na dapat nagse-celebrate kami, I was being wheeled into the operating room for another dilation and curettage procedure. Nung nawala na yung effect ng anesthesia pagbalik ko sa kwarto, bigla na lang ako nag-breakdown. Parang I didn't care that there were nurses na nandun yung OB namin, na may ibang tao. Bigla na lang talaga akong umiyak. Kahit si Erickson, sabi niya sa akin, nagulat siya noon. Kasi nga, as I mentioned, as I've been sharing, hindi ko persona na umiyak basta-basta or magpakita ng kahinaan. But that time, I was so frustrated. I felt betrayed. Parang, bakit? Bakit? Hindi pa ba sapat yung isang beses? Parang kailangan dalawa pa. It was harder for me than Erickson. Siya lang yung naghawak na kamay ko all throughout that time. Pinilit niya pa rin mapasaya yung anniversary namin. Kinasabot niya yung ibang community friends namin na mag-deliver ng flowers sa hospital just to make me smile. But habang nandun sila tapos kinocomfort nila kami, wala akong ma-absorb. Parang, I felt their love, yes. Pero hindi ko magawang mag-respond dun sa sinasabi nila na mabuti ang Diyos, may plano ang Diyos. Kung mabuti ang Diyos, bakit kami nasa hospital ngayon? It was hard for me to believe that God was good at that time. So, it was also around that time na nag-launch yung bagong feast sa Ortigas Galleria, sa Robinson's Galleria. At napag-usapan na namin ni Erickson na after the first trimester, dun kami a-attend. Kasi every Sunday lang, mas madali yung biyahe. Makakapag-surf pa kami kahit whole day. Balap, mapalampas lang namin yung first trimester. But then the miscarriage happened. So sa sobrang tampo ko sa Diyos, hindi talaga kami umattend. Si Erickson, siya uma-attend siya. Pero ako, hindi talaga. Parang sabi ko, magsisimba na lang ako sa parish namin. Pero I just attended mass just for the sake of attending. Parang ginagawa ko lang obligations ko, pero nagtatampo talaga ako. Sobrang tindi ng galit ko talaga nun. Parang hindi ko matanggap. All this time, akala ko ibibigay mo na, tapos hindi pa. Nung na-realize ko, parang, uy, iniingatan pa rin kami ng Diyos. Sabi ko, sige na nga Erickson, sasamahan na kita sa feast. Kasi siya, umaattend talaga siya nung sa Robinson's Gallery. Ako yung ayoko talaga. So, sabi ko, sige, sasamahan na kita, attend na rin ako. Pero yung pag-attend namin, yung attend na laging nasa likod, yung bingi-bingihan kapag nag-a-announce ng need for servants, yung nagmamadaling umalis pagkatapos ng sessions, ganyan. And then, nung natuloy na yung anniversary trip namin, it was a healing experience for me. Parang, bigla akong na-experience kung gaano kabuti yung Diyos. Kasi, I think it was, we were in a park, tapos parang silent lang yung paligid, yung environment. And then, I was praying. I was just desperately asking God, bakit kailangan mangyari lahat ng nangyari? And then, in my heart of hearts, I felt Him say na may hindi ko mapapaliwanag. Pero nandito ako, kahit kailan di kita iniwan. Just look around. Tapos nung narinig ko yung boses niya sa puso ko na yun yung sagot niya sa prayers ko, I looked around. Tapos, nagulat ako na ilang buwan na pala mula nung nawala yung pangalawang anak namin. Pero nakakatayo pa rin ako. I looked around and I saw na imbes na mag-drift apart yung marriage namin ng asawa ko, lalo kaming tumibay together. I looked around and I saw yung mga tao sa paligid namin na hindi napagod mag-reach out sa amin para ipaalala sa aming mahal na mahal pa rin kami ng Diyos at hindi kami nag-iisa, na nasaktan kami pero hindi kami pinabayaan, nawalan kami pero hindi kami iniwan. That even in our pain, God was present and He was journeying with us. So, dun ako talaga umiyak, tapos sumuko ulit sa Kanya. I fully surrendered to His will. Na sige, kung hindi mo ibibigay, hindi. Basta wag mo lang kaming iwan. Kasi 100% sigurado ako, hindi ko kaya kapag wala ka. When we got back, Erickson and I decided na to serve fully. So it was around parang last week ng November, pa-December na. But then, yun nga, unfortunately, the pandemic happened. So parang yun na nag-move ng, nagkakaroon na ng transition, unti-unti, to online. So hindi na kami nakapag-serve talaga on-site. So when we moved online, nung nag-pandemic na nga, parang naging members naman kami ng couples ministry under Brother Anthony Rodriguez and Sister Tina Rodriguez. So sila yung naging parang light group heads namin sa couples ministry. And just to share, sila yung dalawa sa non-stop na nagmahal sa amin nung lumalayo kami because of our pain. Parang sila yung isa sa mga instrumento ng Diyos para ligawan kami pabalik sa Kanya. As I shared before, parang may connotation ako na yung service limited siya sa church activities nung kailangan actively may ginagawa ka. But then, through Brother Anthony and Sister Tina, naramdaman namin na hindi namin kailangang may gawin para mahalin. Mahal nila kami, simply because mahal nila kami. And isa yun sa nagpatunaw nung galit sa puso ko na hindi pala kailangan palagi akong nagbibigay or kailangan palagi akong may pinapatunayan para mamahalin nila kami. They just loved us because they loved us.
During the time, yung first, second, all the miscarriages that they went through, we already knew them, we were journeying with them. And ang galing lang na yung feeling namin na ano bang pwede mong i-share? Kasi hindi naman namin naging concern eh. But the only thing that we could offer was, we were there for them. So there were times that we would just listen, we would just invite them constantly na kung hindi sila available, okay lang. No hard feelings. No hard feelings for that. Diretso lang, constant reminder, eventually. Until the time na, yun, nakwento nga din nila na for a time, nawalan sila ng baby, tas ayaw na rin mag-attend lahat. But I think it helped that they knew that there was someone there for them. Hindi lang siguro kami. I think a lot of people were also there. But kami constant reminding them, oh, nandito lang kami. If you need someone to talk to, kung kailangan nyo lang maglabas ng sama ng loob, please allow us to be your, basurahan nyo, ilabas nyo lang kung anong meron.
Kasi they were really silent. Now, for a few months talaga, talagang they kept quiet. Tapos eventually, they started attending again. Tapos nagtutuon-tus kami with them. Tapos yun nga, nalaman na nga namin na yung struggles nila with their faith. That's when I learned yung power of journeying together. The feast being there as a place where people can come and receive without expecting anything in return. And I think that's what parang the Lord was also teaching us. May time na sinabi talaga nila, pag ready na po kami, babalik po kami. So we were just there praying, hoping na ano, tas yun, bumalik naman sila.
Fast forward to 2022, parang lahat ng feasts under the Ortigas District na moved sa Feast Novotel. So nung nilaunch yung Feast Novotel, we were there also. We attended and we committed to serve. Dun kami, mas din naging active sa Couples Ministry. Parang in-invite kami ni Kuya Anthony to join the core team to represent the Feast Ortigas Galleria. So, sobrang grateful namin ni Erickson because we were given that opportunity na i-continue service namin together. And so, April nilaunch yung Feast Novotel. And then, in May, sobrang na-amaze kami ni Erickson because we found out again that we're pregnant with our third baby. So parang we were very hopeful na ito na yon, ito na talaga yon. Kasi that was the time na we already found an OB perinatologist who would guide us in our pregnancy journey because we found out that we have a rapport immune disorder which may cause multiple miscarriages or recurrent miscarriages. So parang just to a brief, very brief explanation of the rapport immune disorders. It's the tendency of the body to attack the baby kasi parang foreign siya sa katawan ng mommy. So, iba't iba lang yung manifestations dun sa limang categories. But basically, parang ganun yung function niya. We had various laboratory tests. And then, I tested positive sa 2 out of 5 categories. And then, I was being treated as positive dun sa isa pang category, which was APAS. I think yun yung mas kilala na kind ng rapport immune disorder. So, we were confident somehow na dahil nasa, parang nasa tamang tao na kami ganyan, everything would go smoothly. So, our perinatologist referred us to an immunologist to help us co-manage our condition. So, every week we had a treatment to help protect the baby. Sobrang saya namin ni Erickson nun. Tas kasi nalaman namin yung pregnancy namin during the Feast of the Visitation of Mary kay Elizabeth. So parang sabi namin, ang galing, parang di ba yung both yung stories nung pagbubuntis nilang dalawa, imposible, pero parang God made it happen. So yun yung parang pinanghawakan namin. But despite all our efforts, the treatments, and having the best doctors, we still lost our third child. So, we named her Maylee kasi combination ng Mary and Elizabeth kasi feast day nga nung visitation. So, very vivid sa akin yung nangyari na yon. It was Saturday morning. So, meron kaming scheduled treatment again. And then, pagising ko, may spotting ako. So, medyo kinabahan na ako kasi kay Pia sa unang pregnancy, ganun din eh. Parang nagka-spotting din ako. So, when I saw that, ginising ko agad si Erickson, sabi ko, di, may spotting, message ko agad si Doc. Sabi ni Doc, magpa-ultrasound kami agad. So, during the ultrasound, yung sonologist namin, ang una niyang tanong, ma'am, di ba naka-aspirin na kayo? So, yung aspirin is one of the medicines that would help counter or manage the RIDs. Sabi ko, opo. Tapos, tinawag niya yung assistant niya. Sabi niya, ma'am, tingnan mo nga to, may nakikita ka ba? Tapos kinabahan na ako, parang nakita ko na yung ganung muka. Nakita ko na yung sa ilang beses kong trinay na ipa-ultrasound na paulit-ulit si Pia looking for that heartbeat. Alam ko na yung ganung muka. Tapos nung nakita ko yung muka nung tinawag niya ang assistant, naramdaman ko na yung familiar na takot sa puso ko. And then, hinawakan ni Doc yung kamay ko. Sabi niya, ma'am, sorry, wala po akong makitang heartbeat. i-message ko po yung OB nyo ha, kasi wala dun sa hospital yung OB namin, so iba yung naging sonologist. I-message ko po, ah, pipicturean ko lang din po to, ganyan. Tapos nag-explain na siya, tapos parang ang nasabi ko lang sa kanya, Doc, pwede po bang tawagan yung asawa ko? Kasi technically bawal sa loob, pero pinatawag niya. Then nung tinawag si Erickson, umiiyak na ako. Si Erickson yung kinakausap ng sonologist. Wala na kasi. Parang, I was devastated by the news. And paglabas ko, marami pang kailangan ayusing papel. Pero the sonologist gave me that space. Nakita niya kasi na nagigrieve na ako talaga. So I broke down dun sa corridor, sa hospital corridor. Nagdadaanan yung mga tao, tumitingin sila sa akin, parang wala akong pake kasi paulit-ulit kong naririnig yung, Ma'am, I'm sorry, wala po ulit heartbeat. Wala po siyang heartbeat. Tumawag yung mga kapatid ko, nag-video call sila. And wala akong nasabi during the video call. Iyak lang ako ng iyak. Kasi parang minessage ko lang sila na wala na si Maylee. Kasi sila yung nakakita nung kung paano yung treatment namin, yung efforts namin, yung paglalagay ko ng suppository gabi-gabi, yung dami ng gamot na iniinom ko, yung lahat ng laboratories, lahat ng tusok na pinagdaanan namin. Pero wala pa rin si Maylee. And iyak lang kami na iyak ni Erickson dun sa may corridor. Pag-uwi namin ng bahay, tinignan ng mga kapatid ko yung resulta ng ultrasound. Pinipigilan kong umiyak kasi parang kota na ako nung hapon na yun. Tapos nung nakita nung pangatlo kong kapatid yung ultrasound, bigla na lang siyang umiyak ng todo-todo. Tapos umakit siya ng kwarto, tapos ang sinabi niya lang talaga, bakit naman ganun si Jess? Jess kasi yung personal kong tawag kay Jesus. Tapos nagdabog yung kapatid ko, umakyat siya. Sabi niya, bakit naman ganun si Jess? Tapos hinagis niya yung ultrasound result. Tapos nandun yung mama ko, nandun yung bunso kong kapatid. So, kinuha nung bunso kong kapatid yung result, tapos tinignan niya din. Tapos umiyak na lang din siya. Tapos kami ni Erickson, nasa dining area kami nun. Umiyak na lang din kami. We grieved together that night. Tapos yung pamangkin ko na 3 years old yata that time, yakap lang siya ng yakap. Tapos maya't maya tinatanong niya ako, Mami, di pa ba inom ng gamot si Maylee? Kasi gabi-gabi nakikita niya nga na ang dami kong ininom na gamot. Tapos maglalagay ako ng suppository. Mami, si Maylee gugutom na. Tapos na sinasabi sa kanya, ano kasi Luffy, wala na si Maylee. Kasama na siya ni Tia, tsaka ni Niji. Niya, eh, bakit wala? Eh, di ba magpiplay pa kami? Di ba sabi natin kay Jesus, di ba ibibigay siya sa atin? Di ba healthy siya? Tapos hindi ko mapaliwanag sa kanya na wala na si Maylee kasi nga ako hindi ko maintindihan eh. Kung bakit wala na si Maylee. But kung gano'ng kasakit sa akin yung second miscarriage, ganun kasakit yung third para sa asawa ko.
Personally, nahirapan akong maniwala sa Diyos this time. Naalala ko during our prayer time bago matulog. Kasi nasa taas yung altar namin. Naalala ko, sabi ko, hindi ka naman nata totoo eh. Parang hindi mo naman pinapakinggan yung mga dasal namin. Halika nga dito, suntukan tayo. I even challenge him na ganun. Yung sa galit ko na, kasi yung time na yun, wala, 2 years na yun, pero wala pa talaga kaming plano na magbuntis. So, ang feeling ko kasi that time, parang okay naman na kami. Okay naman kami. Kung hindi kami magkakaanak, okay kami. Kasi close naman kami ni Maymay. Nagtatravel naman kami together. Happy naman kami together. Tapos, bibigyan mo kami ng anak, tapos kukunin mo. Ano yun? Anong trip yun? Sabi, parang ganun yung nararamdaman kong ano, that time. Kaya talagang hinamon ko siya. Parang sa galit, parang gusto ko talagang ilabas yung galit ko. Sa sobrang galit ko, talagang hindi na kami ayokong magsimba, intentionally, ayokong magsimba. After ilang months, napilitan lang akong sumama kay Maymay. Pero hindi ako nagpa-participate sa mass. Hindi ako, talagang minamak ko yung mass. Talagang niloloko ko. Talagang hindi ako nagpa-participate. Kasi nagagalit pa din ako. Sa nung time na yon nagagalit pa din ako. Kasi parang hindi fair. Masakit, sobrang sakit. Tapos uulitin ng 3 beses. Kaya nag-struggle talaga ako na makabalik sa faith ko at maniwala sa Diyos.
Ako, on my part, grabe din yung tampo ko. Grabe din yung sakit na nararamdaman ko. But after what happened to Niji, alam ko talaga na wala akong ibang pupuntahan kundi yung Diyos. Parang for me, it would be counterproductive kung lalayo pa ako sa Kanya kasi alam kong at the end of the day, sa Kanya din ako lalapit. So I chose to hold on. Parang kumapit ako kahit parang feeling ko binitiwan niya kami. Kumapit ako kahit ang sakit-sakit, kahit di ko talaga maintindihan yung nangyayari. And I kept on praying for Erickson's heart. Also, kasi grieving kami pareho eh. Hindi namin kaya ng kaming dalawa lang. So, I wanted to hold on to something greater than my own strength. It was around that time na malapit na yung Jewel's conference. For some weird reason, every time na magdadasal ako, I would feel God leading me to attend the Jewel's conference. Which for me, parang it didn't make sense. Parang nagigrieve nga ako eh. Parang nasasaktan nga ako eh. Bakit mo ako papaatinin? Parang gusto kong magkulong. Ayoko makakita ng mga tao. Kung may gusto kong kausapin, gusto ko ikaw lang. But the calling, the leading was so strong. So, sabi ko, sige, attend ako. Parang I would try to attend. Pero yung Sunday before yung feast conference, I asked Erickson kung pwede kaming umattend ng feast muna just to see kung kaya ko ba talagang humarap na sa mga tao, kung kaya ko ba. And Erickson, kahit ayaw niya talaga, he supported me. So we attended the feast. Ang bumungad sa amin sa may venue, sa Feast Novotel, was Sister Joy Cabrillas and Brother Anthony Rodriguez. Sa dinami-dami ng tao sa feast, sila pa talagang dalawa yung bumungad sa amin. And they said nothing. They didn't say anything. Niyakap lang nila kami pareho. Hindi sila nag-preach, hindi sila nagbigay ng word of God, hindi sila nagbigay ng any comforting words or consolation. Niyakap lang nila kami pareho. Tapos, umiyak lang ako nang umiyak sa kanila. Tapos, sobrang tindi nung galit ni Erickson talaga. Parang after nung yakap na yun, sabi niya, wala mo na akong maramdaman. As in, gano'n yung sinabi niya talaga. Tapos parang during mass, bigla siyang lumabas. Parang hindi niya kayang makinig nung sa mga readings, ganyan. Tapos ako naman, all throughout the feast, nakayakap lang ako kay Erickson. I couldn't, even during worship, I couldn't bring myself to sing that God is a way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper. Paano ko kakantahin yun? Hindi ko nga naramdaman. Parang, how would I sing kung hindi ko natanggap yung miracle na pinagdadasal namin? How would I respond amen to what the preacher was saying kung nandun ako with a lifeless baby inside my womb? I felt like a walking tomb na naglalakad ako na may carrying that lifeless baby inside of me. It was so painful. So, pag uwi namin, nagdasal ako. Sabi ko, Lord, hindi ko kayang umattend ng Jewel's conference. And then, there was just silence. Parang papalapit ng papalapit yung Jewel's conference. Sobrang torn pa din ako talaga. Until it was Erickson na who said na, sige na, May, samahan kita. Parang we would book a hotel kasi nga hindi ko pa nalalabas si Millie at that time. So, nasa akin pa siya. He decided to book a hotel para masamahan niya rin ako. And since night shift siya sa work, so para makapag-work pa din siya. And just because, siguro nakikita niya na part of me gusto talaga. Pero iniisip ko lang din siya. Thank you. the day of the Jewel's conference came. So matenda ko. Sa may labas pa lang, ang nagbigay ng kit ko was for one of my former office mates na super ka-close ko, si Ate Angie Esperta. So pag-abot pa lang niya ng kit, nag-iyakan na kami ulit kasi alam niya yung nangyayari, updated siya. Pero hindi kami nag-usap masyado. Tapos parang sabi ko, wala, ilang tao pa yung makakasalubong ko na nakakaalam ng kwento. So parang gusto ko sa sulok lang ako, talaga I decided na parang gusto ko lang magtago. Tapos pagpasok ko ng venue, mag-start na yung mass. So naghanap ako ng space, sa may, parang sa may side. Tapos nakapikit lang ako. First 3 minutes, okay pa ako. Parang safe, walang nakakakita sa akin. Kasi actually, alam ko yung, medyo alam ko yung pwesto ng mga taong kakilala ko eh. So, iniwasan kong dumaan doon or magpakita sa kanila. Siyempre, pag may mga event, diba, itatanong kung may kasama ka kasi may upuan, kailangan nila ng space. Sunod-sunod yung nagtatanong sa akin, sis, may kasama ka ba? Sis, may kasama ka ba? Parang, habang dumadami yung nagtatanong nun, bigla na lang ulit ako nag-breakdown. Tinawagan ko agad si Erickson kahit mas. Kasi sabi ko sa kanya, paano ko sasabihin sa kanila na may kasama ako pero wala siyang buhay? Na, I was not alone but my little companion wasn't there anymore. So, iyak na naman ako ng iyak. Nung nag-worship na, so madilim yung paligid, nakapikit lang ako, tapos may narinig ako nagsalita na, uy, dito tayo, wala pa yatang nakaupo. So umusog ako, dumilat ako, tapos umusog ako para makaupo sila. Lo and behold, yung nagsalita, isa sa mga pinakaka-close ko sa community, si Gretch Beran. So, nagulat talaga ako, parang, nagpapatawa ka ba talaga? Parang, just for context, isa si Gretch talaga sa mga safe friends ko. So, nung umupo na si Gretch, kasama niya si Reese, anak ni na Brother Obet and Sister Joy Cabillas, na feast builder namin sa Feast Manila. Parang, I know I was safe. Kahit umiiyak ako during worship, I know I was safe. So, nung nag-resume akong mag-worship, nag-resume din yung iyak ko. So, iyak lang din ako ng iyak. Pagdilat ko ng mata nung binuksan na yung mga ilaw, I was so sure na magang-maga yung mata ko. Pero Gretch didn't say anything. Tapos nung nag-break time, umalis ako agad, lumabas ako, punyuntahan ko agad si Erickson. Tapos naka-receive ako ng message from Gretch.
It's been quite a while na hindi kami nagkausap. I just know from her social media updates na she's going through a difficult time with their fertility kasi nga, di ba, nagkinasal na sila ni Erickson. Tapos, pagpunta ko doon, instantly biglang, nandito ka rin. So, sabi ko, Lord, gusto ko tahimik lang ako, pero ang galing ha, meron pang bonus na Mimi. Kasi nga, ang tagal namin hindi nagkausap, but I always know na pag nagkakausap kami, it's always deep and connected. So, tahimik lang ako. At tahimik lang din siya. Tapos napansin ko, tuwing nag-worship na, syempre, natural sa atin sa feast, minsan nagiging emotional tayo during worship, pero napansin ko yung iyak niya nun, iba, parang, humahagulgol talaga siya. So, hinayaan ko lang siya umiyak. Tapos, every time nakikita ko, iyak na siya ng iyak. Instead na nakataas din yung kamay ko kasi nag-worship, iyayakap ko na lang siya. Tapos, nirub ko lang talaga yung likod niya kasi parang iyak na iyak talaga siya. So, the whole time, dahil I just, alam mo, hindi niya kinommunicate with words, but I just felt that this must be something really heavy. Kasi nga, Mimi is always a source of positivity for me. Lagi pa rin siyang, I will pray for you, kahit mahirap. Pero nung time na yun, it just seemed like she was really having a difficult time. So yun, nung patapos na actually, dun ko lang nalaman na yun pala yung pinagdadaanan niya nung siya na yung nagkwento. And turns out, she appreciated it so much na I didn't ask. She just really needed someone literally to be there.
All throughout the Jewel's conference, andun lang si Gretch. Parang katabi ko lang siya, nakikinig lang siya. And honestly, wala akong masyadong maalala sa nangyari sa conference. Sa mga talks, sa mga ganyan. Very little. But what I do remember was after the Jewel's conference, nakita ko yung mga common friends namin ni Gretch. And they knew the story. Tapos grabe yung yakap nila sa akin. And yung pag-approach nila and telling me na they were praying for us ni Erickson, that they're just there. Tapos parang nung may isang lunch break, nakita ko yung dati nga naming light group head. Tapos yung mga dati kong office mates. They were just embracing us. Tapos nagulat ako dun sa overwhelming love na binibigay nila. parang na-remind ako na shucks, hindi talaga kami nag-iisa. Parang, I belong to a family. Talaga, not just a community. Naramdaman ko yung pagmamahal, yung pag-journey with us, even through their prayers and their embraces. Tapos nung habang naglalakad ako palabas, as I mentioned, punong-puno ng gratitude yung puso ko. Tapos na-realize ko na hindi pala ako pinapunta doon ni Lord para makinig. Pinapunta pala niya ako doon para mahalin. Na hindi lang pala niya ako gustong umaten doon kasi gusto niya lang guluhin yung buhay ko or gusto niya lang punuin ako ng teachings. Gusto niya pala akong punuin ng pagmamahal. Pumasok ako doon na nagtatanong, pumasok ako doon na nasasaktan. Lumabas ako na punong-puno ng pagmamahal. And I didn't know na habang hinihil niya ako, hinihil niya rin si Erickson because Erickson was having his me time during that time kasi nga ayaw niya talagang magbabad anywhere around any religious activity or feast activity. Pero sabi niya, paglabas ko, nagulat ako, sabi niya, Mia, alam mo habang nag-feast, habang nag-Jewel's conference ka, something in him daw compelled him to read back all the messages na natatanggap namin and yung love daw na pinaparating sa amin. Tapos nagulat daw siya na by the time na natapos siyang basahin lahat yun, umiiyak na siya and then there was peace in his heart. Sabi niya, sobrang galit ko lang pala kaya hindi ko naramdaman yung pagmamahal ng Diyos. Tapos sa kanya nang galing yung term, sabi niya, nakakahil yung pagmamahal, no? Sabi ko, oo nga. Parang, I've never been this grateful to be part of this community, of this family. Na siguro kung tayo lang dalawa, baka hindi talaga natin kayanin. That's when I realized na kung masyado tayong paralyzed ng pain, we can always allow other people to carry us closer to God. Kasi hindi naman kahinaan yung magpamahal. And that night, we just worshiped the Lord. Talaga, dun sa hotel, habang nasa hotel kami, we just sang worship songs, we just surrendered to God, and we just really opened up our wounds to Him. Tapos, sabi namin sa Kanya, whatever your will, may your will be done. Kung ano man yun. And if anything, nagpapasalamat kami talaga na sobrang laking biyaya na okay yung marriage namin ni Erickson at napapalibutan kami ng strong support system around us. Grieving but grateful. Grieving because I took this photo after our first miscarriage. Ito yung right after nung dilation and curettage namin with Pia. So I was really grieving. Pero habang tinitingnan ko lang si Erickson na nakabantay sa akin sa hospital, nagpapasalamat yung puso ko na siya yung taong pinakasalan ko. Nagpapasalamat ako kasi God just continues to strengthen our marriage. Parang ang hirap harapin ng mga ganitong problema kung maling tao yung kasama mo. 'Di ba? Parang ang hirap kapag kaming dalawa mismo yung may conflict sa isa't isa. Pero through and through, sa bawat trial na pinagdaanan namin, lalo naming napatunayan na magkakampi kami. Na we are one. And I'm just really very grateful to be married with Erickson.
Nung time na nag-struggle ako dun sa third miscarriage, naging faithful pa rin siya kay Lord. Hindi ko nakita na sinabayan niya ako sa pag-garant. Never kong nakita na hindi dapat faithful ka eh. Dapat tiwala ka pa din. Never niya sinabi sa akin yun. Never niyang in-impose na maging okay ako agad kay Lord. Never niyang in-impose na dapat faithful ako kay Lord. Dahil sa mga actions niya na yun, mas nag-heal ako. Dun sa, ayoko kasi yung fino-force ako, lalo sa mga ganong bagay. So nakita ko yun sa kanya, at naging instrument yun ng pag-heal ko, pabalik kay Lord. Mas naging close kami after nung nangyari. Siguro dahil masakit sa amin parehas, kino-comfort namin yung isa't isa.
I remember during our Christology class, parang tinanong kami ng professor namin, why did you think Thomas doubt about the resurrection of Jesus. So parang nag-iisip kami, bakit nga ba? O nga, no, bakit nga ba siya naging doubting Thomas? And then our professor said, it's because when Jesus reappeared, he was not with his community. Nakahiwalay siya, naka-isolate siya. And it really created an impact on me. Naisip ko na it's really easier to doubt. It's easier to lose faith. It's more tempting to lose your faith if you're not part of a community or kung hindi mo kasama yung community mo in times of trials. And we are grateful ni Erickson because we found not just a community but a family through the feast. And I think that's my main reason why I would continue and would never get tired of inviting people to join the feast. It's because it helps you have that accountability in your faith journey with the Lord. Being in the community, being at the feast, helped me to experience God's love more in a personal way. Parang yung mga tao sa paligid namin, sila yung naging tangible na representation ng pagmamahal ng Diyos sa amin. What used to be just something from the scriptures became alive through the love of the people around us. Yung concern nila sa amin, yung pag-reach out nila sa amin, yung pangungumusta nila, yung pag-set aside nila ng time nila para i-date kami, tapos kumustahin kami. Sobrang laking part nun sa healing journey namin. And it made me realize that God really uses people to reach us out and to love us in whatever season we may be. After having gone through multiple miscarriages, I think right now, mas nakilala ko yung Diyos na gusto kong makilala nung bata ako. Na parang what started as parang a quest to know God, ngayon binigyan niya ako ng opportunities to know Him in a very personal way. And I learned that even if sometimes it seems that God is silent in our prayers, He's not deaf. God responds not in words but in deeds. And in our case, nung akala ko hindi siya nakikinig, sinasagot niya pala yung mga dasal namin through the people around us. He kept sending people, and even until now, He keeps sending people to help us get through, to know Him more, to survive each day, to face each day with hope from all those pains na pinagdaanan namin.